Λοιπόν, καλησπέρα σε όλους τους φίλους. Είναι άλλο ένα επεισόδιο για την εκπομπή μας, για το Court Seat, την Μυρωδιά της Σπυριάρας, και απόψε είναι πολύ μεγάλη μας χαρά και πολύ μεγάλη μας τιμή να έχουμε μαζί μας τον κύριο Τόνι Ντέλκ, ο οποίος είναι ο πρώτος Αμερικανός καλεσμένος μας και βεβαίως ένας από τους πολύ μεγάλους παίκτες που έχουν περάσει και από την Ευρώπη. Mr. Delk, thank you for the acceptance of our invitation.
Oh, no problem. Thank you guys for having me on. And I know it's a little late over there and a little early over here, but so I wanted to kind of get it in before you guys got a chance to go out. And I know you can't party like we once did. you know, we still have to practice our social distance. So, but still, though, no, wonderful. Thank you guys for having me on. I appreciate it.
There are two reasons why we can't go out. It is the coronavirus and our children. We have babies at home, so
inside, yeah,
it's difficult. Okay, we will begin with saying that Mr. Delk is an NCAA champion in 1996 with Kentucky.
He and MVP, and MVP in the finals, in the Final Four.
Yes, Kentucky had a very good team at that year with Antoine Walker and Ron Mercer, and of course Mr. Delk, who was, I believe, the star of the team. And after that, he had a very very good NBA career, and he was here also in Greece with Panathinaikos, and he conquered the Euroleague in 2007. So this is a short biography of our guest tonight, and I will give the microphone now to Mike for our first question.
Good evening, Mr. Delk.
Mike, how's it going?
You stayed 4 years in college, and you became a legend there with, of course, your epic Final Four back in 1996. But their players leave colleges early now and join NBA. How do you evaluate this situation?
I think it's great for players, you know, to have an opportunity to fulfill their dream. You know, that's the most important thing, is that all these kids grow up watching NBA players. And, you know, I idolized Dr. J as well as Michael Jordan. Yeah. They get a chance really to go to college and put yourself in a position to be a draft pick. I mean, it's the most exciting thing that a kid could possibly do, because we start playing this game at such an early age and we don't know which direction is going to take us. We just love it. And you get a chance to get a scholarship, you go to, you know, a major university. And as I tell kids, I do a lot of teaching, is that there's so many layers to basketball, you know, from middle school to high school to college and to the NBA. And some guys get a chance to, you know, to skip that collegiate level, like, you know, Kobe Bryant, LeBron James, Kevin Garnett. And you're seeing more and more guys leave as 19-year-old kids, because the league, the NBA was, you know, they allowed it to happen. You know, if it wasn't for the NBA, you know, because they could be like NFL. NFL, you can't enter your name into the NFL draft, which is football. For those who don't know, NFL is football over here.
Yes.
You can't enter the draft until you're a junior in college. So the NBA, you have to be 19 years of age and just have completed 1 year of college. So the opportunity for basketball players happen a lot sooner. And to me, I think it's okay. I'm not a huge component of not allowing guys who are physically ready to play to play on the next level. So I'm not one of those guys that I'm older now and I'm retired and I'm hating on the younger guys because they got a chance to play before.
Okay.
I really, like to say, great for those guys to get a chance to put themselves in position to take care of their families.
You mentioned the NFL, and I'm one of the few Greeks who like American football. Do you think Trevor Lawrence is one of the best prospects ever?
I think he is, man. He's been good for, you know, ever since he's been in college.
I have no idea about this.
Mike, you got to listen up, Mike. But no, he's probably one of the most efficient quarterbacks, and he's played so many good games where, you know, he's not one of those guys that when you look at him, say, wow, you know, he's 6'5", 6'6", frame. But he understands the game. He has a really great IQ, a great feel for the game. And he's played with so many great guys. But also, he's well-coached. Dabo Sweeney, who's the coach for Clemson Tigers, you know, he's done an exceptional job bringing good talent there. But, Mike, you get a chance, man. Maybe watch some college, some college football, man. Oh, there'll be a really good game tomorrow for you to watch, Mike. I don't know what time it'll be coming on there, but University of Georgia against the University of Alabama. That's a big time game, number 2 versus number 3 in college football.
Is Nick Saban available for the game? Because I think he's positive with the coronavirus.
No, he won't be there tomorrow.
Okay.
Coronavirus taking one of the best coaches in the game away. So, hey, Mike, we got to get you updated on some other sports other than basketball, man, and soccer.
Okay. I'm going to have. He doesn't like soccer
enough. Okay, Tony, tell us some words about your legendary draft, about your bench. You picked up many players like Iverson, of course, Kobe Bryant, Stojakovic.
It was a really talented draft, you know, and at that time, I don't think any of us coming out knew anything about Kobe Bryant. You know, I think Kobe kind of came on the scene, whereas, you know, there were a few high school guys that came out. I think Jermaine O'Neal was another high school player.
Yes.
And Kobe Bryant was the other one. And it might have been a couple other guys, but all the guys from Iverson to, of course, my two teammates, Antoine Walker, Walter McCarty, who got drafted in the first round. John Wallace was a McDonald's All-American teammate of mine, and we faced each other 3 years, three out of my 4 years at Kentucky. He was at Syracuse. And then you take the likes of Eric Dampier, who played at Mississippi State, Kerry Kittles. We played against Stephon Marbury. I mean, we played – there were so many – Lorenzen Wright was a good friend of mine growing up in Tennessee. So I knew all of these guys, probably with the exception of maybe Kobe Bryant was the only one I didn't know, and he turned out to be – probably of all the players, probably the best guy, you know, 5-time champion out of that 1996 draft class. So to me, not to be biased, I think it was definitely the deepest and the best draft that we've probably ever seen, because you look at the front end, the front of the draft was good and the back end of the draft was good. And even think about Derek Fisher. He's a 5-time NBA champion. He was like the 26th pick. In the 96 draft. So that draft was loaded. That draft had so many talented players that, you know, Kobe was probably the last of the Mohican to retire, you know, from that 96 draft a couple of years ago.
Yeah. We had a Greek player drafted 1996, Evthymis Retzias. Do you remember Evthymis, that name?
Who was this?
Evthymis Retzias.
Retzias.
I don't know him. He must win late in the second round. And once my Kentucky guys got drafted, I think Mark Pope was another one of the Kentucky players who I played with that won a championship.
Mark Pope, yes.
Mark Pope, yeah.
7 or 8 years in the NBA, and also he's now the head coach at BYU, which is Brigham Young University. So he's gone on to become a head coach. But, you know, back to that draft, I think there was just so many really good players, you know, and even as great as Pager was, he didn't even come over to like another 2 or 3 years. You know, he didn't actually doing that draft. He waited and stayed overseas. And when he came, I mean, was probably one of the best shooters that I played with. I got a chance to play with Pager in Sacramento and we became good friends. And, but, you know, just had a great feel for the game, but was a guy who was really could catch and shoot, put the ball on the floor. He got better. Each and every year, you could see him improving and getting better. And I think playing with the Sacramento Kings with Mike Bibby, Vlade Divac, Bobby Jackson, Doug Christie. They had such good chemistry.
White Chocolate also.
Yeah. They had such good chemistry. The only team they really couldn't beat was the Lakers. You know, I think they were so solid.
They were very unlucky at the game when Robert Horry scored this buzzer beater.
Yeah. You know, Vlade tipped the ball out, and he happened to tip the ball out to Big Game Rob, a 7-time NBA champion. But that Sacramento team was one of my favorite teams I played on. You know, I would have loved to have stayed there and, you know, maybe finished my career, played a few more years. But at the time, I became a free agent, and Phoenix Sun offered me a really good deal, and I really couldn't turn the deal down.
I will go back to the draft. Tell me the feelings of a 22-year-old guy like you going into the draft, are you afraid that you will go low? Are you hopeful that you will go high? What are your feelings 2 days before the draft and during the draft?
I think when most of these guys, even now, it's going to be a little bit different how they handle the draft this year because of the COVID-19. But you actually go and work out for these teams. So I went and worked out for Sacramento, who had like maybe, I want to say that the 10th pick, and they chose Pace or Jokic, and then the Lakers had the 26th pick. So I worked out for the Lakers, Sacramento. I worked out twice for Charlotte. I had a really good workout with Cleveland. So you kind of look at the range that you're being drafted in. And the range I was going to be drafted in is between 10 and 26. So that put me in the mid of the mid first round. So I was excited about, you know, just being, you know, going to be selected in the mid first round. So, but when you're really coming out, you're really not concerned with that. I think you just want to get drafted and, you know, play and fulfill your dream. And, you know, so even the days leading up to it, I really wasn't that nervous because I had worked out twice for Charlotte. So Charlotte had the number 13 and 16th pick, and Cleveland had two picks in the first round in 1996. But I kind of knew they were going to go with two bigs. I think with Elgoskis and Vitaly Potapenko, something like that.
Vitaly Potapenko, the Ukrainian.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. The Ukrainian, yeah.
So at that time, I knew they were going to draft two bigs. So Charlotte was looking for two guards. And it was kind of tailor-made for me to be drafted, you know, 13 or 16. But Charlotte had already had a plan on what they was going to do with the 13th pick, which they ended up trading that to the Lakers for Vlade Divac. And so the 16th pick fell right into my lap. You know, I was excited about it, you know, not being too far from home, not being out west. And, you know, whenever you get drafted, I mean, it's one of the most exciting times for any player.
Of course.
Okay.
Were you ready to be an NBA player? I mean, emotionally, not physically. I mean, okay, all NCAA players have the dream of becoming an NBA player. But when you start a game in the NBA, how does it feel? Is it what you expected to be or something different?
She was a champion.
I really don't, like you said, you know, coming from Kentucky, you know, with the media, having a great coach, Coach Pitino, who coached on the NBA.
Rick Pitino, yes.
Like Rick Pitino.
He was preparing us to be NBA players. So it wasn't like, you know, I got there and I was overwhelmed, you know, because I was already practicing against really good players, you know, with Derek Anderson, Ron Mercer. I was practicing against pros. So even in the summertime, when Jamal Mashburn, Rex Chapman, mm-hmm. Kenny Skywalker, Sam Bowie, those guys would come back and play with us in the summertime, and some other guys that were playing overseas basketball. So when you're competing and going against pros, is that now it's just it's an easier transition when we've already practiced and seen those guys. So it wasn't like I was scared or I was intimidated. You know, I was physically ready. You know, I was a physically strong player because of my work ethic and how much I love being in the weight room. So it wasn't that difficult of a transition. Like most people, like, oh man, going to the next level, like how hard? It wasn't that hard. You know, now just stepping on the court and competing against the players that, you know, that of course I watched on TV and I grew up idolizing.
Okay.
Okay. Let's discuss about your experience in Europe. You came at Panathinaikos 2007. You played a little bit in the final. Do you remember that match with CSKA?
You know what? Coach Obradovic was a really, really good coach. You know, I think when I went over, I wasn't that familiar with the European game. So it was a harder transition for me because I had spent some years in NBA playing at a different level, but also just being able to know I'm in the rotation, I'm going to play. You know, we didn't practice. We practiced a lot there. You know, I was at the end of my career, you know, it really was more about stepping on the court, being ready to play. Like I was mentally ready to play. Physically, I was ready to play. So it wasn't like going overseas and you teaching me how to play basketball. I already knew how to play basketball. So I just really wanted to get out there and play. And I think Demetridis was probably, man, he was such a good point guard, man. I You know, we had many conversations about him just going to the NBA. He was very curious, but I knew he wasn't going to leave his country to come and, you know, and play in the NBA. But he had an NBA game, you know, and then Mike Batiste was an unbelievable teammate, you know. So it was a fun time. I wish I could have stayed longer to get.
You mean as a teammate or as a player?
Just as both, a teammate and as a player. Both. Mike was a great teammate and a great player. I wish I could have stayed longer, just really to get better at the European game. You know, I felt like I had an injury that really set me back with my shoulder, and by the time I came back, you know, I was out of the rotation. So that time, you know, they were playing really good basketball. So it wasn't anything personal. You know, when I left Greece, but when I left, my mom was passed. My mom got really sick, and I had to leave abruptly. So it wasn't like, you know, Tony Dell came and he just left. Like, you know, my mom ended up dying when I came home. So actually, it was tough for me in 2007 when I left Greece to come back home. So I still had a few more really good years left in my body. But that toll of losing my mom just took everything out of me, man. I just didn't have the fight, the drive, and, you know, and that's when I decided, you know, maybe it's time for me to take the shoes off, man, and maybe find another profession to get into.
Tell us about today's NBA. Do you think it is a very different sport from what you were playing? I mean, with the three-pointers and the quick rhythm.
I think today's game would be better suited for me, to be honest with you. Not to say I didn't enjoy playing in the 90s and into the 2000s. I just think just how open the game is, shooting threes, and then just being able to play an up-tempo game. So playing an up-tempo game, you know, is something that's so important to me that, you know, when you see how the game is today with guys shooting threes and running up and down the court, it's so important to understand how the game is being played. So I love where the game is at. There's so many great players, and it's such a versatile game where you see guys 1 through 5, all guys can handle the ball. You know, the court is so open right now. When I came in 96, you started seeing it was a power forward in the center. So those guys really occupied the low block. So as a good guard that can penetrate, you couldn't go anywhere. Those bigs wasn't moving. So the game is now, you know, I mean, really they shrunk the court. Like, you know, if you played with a Charles Barkley, if you played with a Karl Malone, a Patrick Ewing, Alonzo Mourning, these guys were all post-up players. So you have to throw the ball into them, and then you have to work, you know, setting screens and moving. But how the game is right now is such a wide open game. Like, I love the NBA right now because it shows the versatility of 1 through 5.
Once upon a time, you scored 53 points without a three-pointer, right?
that's like, I think in today's game, when people speak about that 50-point game, you know, everyone thinking like, man, you know, I'm a shorter player. Like, how many threes did you have? I said, man, I only attempted 1 3. So I was kind of like in a different zone. And my game was not, I mean, of course I could shoot threes. I took what the defense gave me. Like, if you chase me up the three-point line, I was very happy shooting a 1-2 dribble pull-up, a catch and shoot inside the three-point line. I just played my game. And that was one of the reasons why when I left Sacramento to go and play for Phoenix Sun, who at that time, Scott was the coach, you know, he used to call me Buckets. You know, like every time he's like, Buckets, go in the game. So he was like, go get them buckets, whether it's from the 3 inside foul line layup. He said, just go play your game. And if the 3-point shot is there, take it. But if not, take the shot you feel most comfortable taking. And that's kind of how I advise kids now is that, you know, when I start seeing the youth play basketball, everybody wants to shoot threes. I'm just like, it's one thing to shoot them, but how many are you really making?
Yes, it's not that easy. It's not that easy. And this is something that many people comment about, that because of Steph Curry, every young child thinks that they can make threes, but it's not that easy, yes.
Except okay. Ben Simmons, okay.
So I want to ask another question, and this will be our last question. Talk to us, because life is not only basketball. Talk to us, if you would like, about your foundation. It is a very important work that you are doing there.
What exactly it is and how it works?
Well, you know what? That foundation is, I kind of turned over to my daughter. It's a sickle cell foundation. I have two kids that have sickle cell disease, which is a disease that affects your some of your immune, but mostly your red blood cells. So really, it's a disease that my ex-wife, she was a trait carrier. I was a trait carrier. And we had two kids that had sickle cell disease. So, you know, I've been dealing with that for 22 years, but she's an amazing daughter. Her name is Taylor. I have Bella, I have Trinity. But Taylor and Trinity are the ones that are affected with sickle cell disease. So I've learned a lot, given a lot of money, and, you know, it's been something that's been near and dear to my heart. But also, you know, during this time, I also came out with a wine label that's called Wildside Winery. It's called Lorenzo's, and you can get that wine at wildsidewinery.com. So that's another one of my causes that I gave money to Kentucky Children's Hospital. 15% of the profit is going to the hospital. So if you like wine, wildsidewinery.com, Cabernet, Riesling, and Chard. So I do a lot of things where I like to give back. And like I said, the first thing I ever started with was a foundation that was called Taylor Duck Sickle Cell Foundation. And I've kind of grown on, I think this month I'm also doing some marketing and trying to raise money for breast cancer awareness. So I'm constantly spending my time giving money to great causes for so many great people.
This is very well. This is very good. Okay. Mike, do you have any questions?
No.
Okay, Mr. Delk, we thank you very, very much. It was a big honor that you spent some time with us.
Appreciate it,
man. We thank you, we admire you, and we hope the best for you, for your future and your family.
Thank you. Hey, same to you and your kids, man. Hey, stay safe and a blessing to you guys.
Thank you very much.
Thank you a lot.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye.